as well as even upstairs. So we really appreciate you making the time to learn about an important and important issue for this administration. And I was just in London on Friday, and this was all anybody wanted to talk about, an all-day meeting on U.S. Transatlantic relations, because people were perpetually scared that the big deal between the Trump administration and Moscow is imminent, and it will undercut U.S. support for allies or put some of those who are at risk or at doubt. So thank you for being here. The discussion, reducing tensions between NATO and Russia. This is a Center for Preventive Action meeting. We're here in large part to support and celebrate an excellent Council special report. If you haven't gotten your copy, downloaded it, or shared it with a friend, I highly recommend Professor Kim Marten's Reducing Tensions Between Russia and NATO. This was a report a long time in the making, and it is already getting being one of the most downloaded read things that we've done at CFR in some time, so we're very excited about it. I was just over at the NSC there, and people knew about it and were sharing it there because they're doing their strategic reviews in the meantime as well. Just three quick reminders for Council rules. This is a on-the-record discussion, which means it can be for attribution. But as always, if you want further clarification, probably come and speak to the speakers rather than try to capture what you thought they said on your own. Please turn off your cell phones or your PDAs or however you connect to your home office. And when it comes down to Q&A, because we don't have the typical name cards to tilt vertically, put your hand up and I will call on folks in roughly the orders that your names went up. I remind people that a question is an interrogative statement. at some point ends with a question mark. So please feel free to weigh in, but also to take advantage of the scholars and practitioners on stage with their knowledge. I won't spend much time introducing either of the speakers, because if you don't know who they are, you're probably in the wrong room. But we have a great mix, both of deep substantive expertise from Professor Marten, who is at Barnard College in Columbia and will be going on to a yet unannounced position as an international affairs fellow with the Council on Foreign Relations next year. So we'll be literally taking the expertise that she has and putting it to practice in the field, which is so important. And Ambassador Vershbow, who among other places has been the U.S. ambassador to Korea, NATO, and Russia, which are three countries that are of interest, or three postings that are certainly of interest to this current administration, to our studies now. So we're gonna go with each of the speakers in the order left to right here, 7 to 10 minutes, and then I will abuse my chair as prerogative chair to ask a question or two, and we open it up to discussions. So Kim, please kick us off.
Thank you, Micah. And I just want to start out by thanking everybody at the Council who made this possible. So Richard Haas, Jim Lindsay, Paul Steers, and then especially both Micah Zenko and Jennifer Wilson have been just terrific throughout this entire process, giving me lots of feedback. The external advisory team that was led by Angela Stent, and also all the people who spoke with me both on and off the record as I was writing it, including Sandy Vershbow, who I had just sent him a very early draft of where I thought I was going so he'd have some background before I interviewed him, and he returned it to me with all kinds of comments and suggestions and actually had a big impact on how the report went, even though I think he and I probably disagree on some things, so that's okay.
We'll
but, and thank you all for coming on this miserable day outside. So, you know, at the moment, I have some concern that probably all of us share, that because we are focusing so much on Russia's 2016 interference in the elections, that there is a danger of being backward-looking rather than forward-looking in our policy. And we need some sort of coherent, cohesive way to think about how we are going to approach Russia and how we are going to approach the Putin regime going forward. We know that Putin has been very aggressive and very provocative. We know that some of the dangerous military encounters that were very common in past years have started up again. People had thought that now maybe that there was a new administration in the United States, they wouldn't be happening. But as of a couple weeks ago, we know that they were once again starting with Russian aircraft flying too quickly, too close to U.S. and NATO, either aircraft or seagoing vehicles. We know that the arms control regime has atrophied and is now newly threatened by the possibility of the Intermediate Nuclear Forces Treaty falling apart. And the danger of that is not merely what arms control can accomplish in terms of cooperation, but that once you stop having arms control regimes, you stop having the ability to communicate with each other about strategic thinking, and that means that if a crisis arises, people are in a much more dangerous situation than if they are talking to each other. And meanwhile, we also have the ongoing election processes in Europe, with France coming up next, where we know that Russia is trying to intervene, and we're not sure what the ultimate outcome of that is going to be or what it's going to mean for NATO going forward. So a very dangerous situation where we really need some sort of coherence in how we react to things. And so I hope that the report that I've done might be one small contribution to coherence. And let me just tell you a little bit about where this report had its origins. It was really my reaction to a report that came out of the RAND Corporation in early 2016. And I think there may be some people from RAND in the audience. And if there are, I'd really appreciate hearing your side of this and your pushback on this. But the RAND report said that Russia had the military capability to march right up to the borders of the capital cities of Latvia and Estonia within a period of 60 hours, and there was nothing that NATO could do to stop them. And then at that point, there would be this terrible situation where NATO couldn't get forces in because of Russian area access denial activities that would go into place. And the recommendation that came out of that report is that the Baltic states should have a total of seven brigades, which would mean adding four new brigades to the Baltic area right outside of Russia. And I don't disagree with what the war game showed, but my goodness, the policy implications really got me thinking. And the questions that rose in my mind were, first of all, why would Russia really want to do this? You know, the Baltic countries have had their independence for 25 years. It would be really hard for Russia to occupy those areas and actually control them, so that would be difficult. We certainly have all kinds of responses that could be given to Russia outside of traditional conventional force thinking about things. We could think about the possibility of very strong sanctions. We still have the ability to kick Russia out of the SWIFT network, for example, of banking communications, which is what we know from recent experience is what got Iran on board relatively recently. We can think about, you know, battlefield cyber capabilities. And I'm not talking about offensive cyber attacks against civilians. What I mean is all the ways that we might be able to send Russian forces off course and interrupt their ability to communicate with their own headquarters, which is something that war games usually don't take into account, but that certainly is a part of the world that we're facing now. You know, and it also occurred to me that during the Cold War, we never tried to match Soviet conventional superiority in Europe. That was never the goal of the United States or NATO. We always thought about things in terms of offset strategies, whether that meant the ability to use nuclear weapons first if the Soviets were to launch such an attack, or later on, the ability to use stealth technology against the Soviet homeland that at that time there wasn't really a Soviet ability to respond to very well. And so my sense was that we could think about more creative deterrent options than merely thinking about a huge conventional force buildup that would really be violating some of the obligations that we reached with Russia back when we had a more cooperative relationship in the 1990s. And I think the fundamental problem is we don't really know what Putin's goals are. We know that he's being aggressive, but we don't know why. Is it truly that he wants to reestablish Russian control over the former Soviet space? Is it truly that he believes he can break NATO and have it just disintegrate? Or could it also be that he's just trying to use his aggressive maneuvers as a way, in a sense of his own deterrent capabilities, of saying, you know, he didn't know what was going to happen in the upcoming administration in the United States. For a long time, he certainly believed that Hillary Clinton was going to win and that she'd be more aggressive. Is it possible that, at least in part, his aggression was just being driven by this goal to say to the United States, we're still here, watch out, you can't push us around too much? And ultimately, I got really afraid that if we were to build up our conventional forces so strongly on that place that's very vulnerable in the Russian way of thinking about things, that might provoke them to carry out some of the very aggressions that we're afraid that might happen. So in the report itself, I go through some of the scenarios of how a crisis might arise, and I give a series of policy recommendations, and we can go into these in great depth if you want to, but basically my policy policy recommendations are that we combine really strong deterrence, that we make it clear that the United States' extended deterrent to NATO is still in place, with a creative way of thinking about deterrence, combined with reassurance to Russia, recognizing that Putin is probably paranoid, that the Russian military carries out exercises that imply that they believe that there's actually going to be a NATO attack on Russian territory, and to get across the fact that NATO is a defensive alliance that does not have offensive goals towards Russia. And the argument that I make is that the way to combine deterrence and reassurance is to follow international law and international obligations and be as transparent and as coherent as possible in the kind of approach that we take. And I'll stop there.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, thanks very much. It's good to be here today and see some old friends. And as I think many of you know, Russia and NATO have been kind of the twin threads that have run through my entire career, which spans, I hate to admit, 40 years. And I spent a lot of time working directly on the NATO-Russia partnership, and I was part of the negotiating team that worked on the NATO-Russia Founding Act, which celebrates its 20th anniversary next month. So this is a subject that's very near and dear to my heart, although it's one filled with many frustrations. But perhaps symbolically, I began the first of my three different assignments to NATO in the summer of 1991, just a day after the failed coup against Gorbachev, which seemed at the time like the last gasp of a dying system, and it appeared to open up new vistas for cooperation that would go beyond any old Cold Warrior's wildest imagination. I remember writing my first cable at NATO called NATO in the Post-Soviet Era, which suggested turning the whole original mission of NATO inside out and building an integrated security system with a place for a democratic Russia as an integral part of the system. And that is still the right goal that we should pursue, but I think in light of the events of the last 3 years, it's a goal that has never really seemed much more distant than it is now. So I want to praise Kim's report, which I think provides an excellent and a concise review of the history of NATO-Russia relations, what the two sides sought to achieve back in the 1990s, and also the roots of today's tensions. It offers a comprehensive framework for managing what is a competitive relationship and likely to remain a competitive one for years to come. There's a lot of specific recommendations in the report, and I agree with many of them, although I do have some reservations about the overarching paradigm, which you just alluded to, which is that we need to reassure Russia as much as we need to deter Russia. I kind of balked when I read that. Now, of course, we need to understand the Russians' point of view and think through the consequences of our own words and our own actions. We and our allies should only do what is truly necessary to ensure our security and discourage Russian aggressiveness. And we should certainly treat Russian leaders with respect. I think it was a mistake by President Obama to refer to Russia as a regional power and to refer to Putin himself as the bad boy slacking off in the back of the classroom. But still, a lot of the current Russian narrative about NATO's betrayal, humiliation, and encirclement following the end of the Cold War needs to be taken with a very big grain of salt. It should be viewed in the context of their ongoing information campaign aimed at dividing NATO and the EU, fueling transatlantic differences, and stirring up public opposition in Western countries to the relatively modest measures being taken by the alliance to bolster our defense and deterrence posture in the wake of their aggression against Ukraine. And I think the drivers for the Russians' confrontational stance are as much domestic as they are a reaction to NATO's actions, so we shouldn't take what they say at face value. Now, it wasn't so long ago that we and the Russians were working together to overcome Cold War divisions and build security on a cooperative, mutually beneficial basis. I think it's fascinating to look at the now declassified records of the Reagan-Gorbachev and Bush-Gorbachev summits. You can see that in those days, we were really speaking the same language about a common European house, about shared values of freedom, liberty, and human rights. Perestroika and glasnost became part of our vocabulary. And this continued under Yeltsin and even into the first few years of Putin's regime. The Russians seemed to welcome Western ideas and Western assistance. They seemed to understand the need for an open economy and a vibrant civil society as the keys to Russia's own future, and it wasn't just to please or mimic the West. Now, of course, the Russians never liked NATO enlargement, and they were very disappointed when Bill Clinton decided that Partnership for Peace wasn't enough, and in 1994 decided to push for opening up NATO's door. And perhaps the Russians made a fateful mistake at that time when, after suggesting that they were interested in NATO membership, including this dramatic telegram that Yeltsin sent to the first meeting of the North Atlantic Cooperation Council ministerial right after the Soviet Union had dissolved, and he declared that Russia was interested in joining NATO, they shifted the focus to partnership. Maybe that was a mistake, and maybe they didn't want to be on the same level as Luxembourg and Portugal. But be that as it may, I think we managed to develop a pretty effective and flexible framework based on the two-track approach, and Kim describes this in the report. Track one, of course, was a conditions-based approach to NATO enlargement, and track two was a strategic partnership with Russia to be formalized, institutionalized through a charter of some kind with permanent mechanisms for cooperation and consultations. And I think throughout the 1990s, we did, on both sides, have a kind of a spirit of trying to do as much as we could to make the most of the NATO-Russia cooperative framework, to aim for joint action on as many issues as possible where our interests were aligned. And you saw this, I think, most significantly in the 90s in the Russian involvement in the peacekeeping operations in Bosnia and later in Kosovo. Particularly after 9/11, we expanded the agenda to cover counterterrorism, cooperation on Afghanistan, theater missile defense. And although there was a short pause after the Georgia War, NATO did its own reset. And with Medvedev, we set the goal of a true strategic partnership. And we're beginning to talk about what could have been a game-changing relationship in cooperative missile defense against rogue states. Now, also during the 90s, we undertook enormous efforts to make clear to the Russians that enlargement was a political project, and it was not directed against Russia. And this, of course, was reflected in the unilateral pledges that NATO made not to deploy nuclear weapons or substantial combat forces on the territory of new members. And Kim is one of the first to accurately reflect the very complex issue of what exactly did we mean by substantial combat forces. But beyond the commitments, what you saw after 1997 was a real period of disarmament on both sides in Europe. The U.S. had about 100,000 troops in Europe in 1997, and by 2012, all we had left in terms of ground forces was two brigade combat teams. Russia also shifted its forces away from its western flank, even after the Baltic states were admitted, because both sides concluded that there was simply no chance of a conflict in Europe. And conflict was truly inconceivable, at least until 2014. So I think Russia obviously very much changed its outlook and kind of retroactively tried to revise its historical narrative accordingly. But I do believe that the change was much more about domestic politics. As Kim emphasizes in the report, a key driver was Putin's fear of regime change in the wake of the Arab Spring, the toppling of Gaddafi, and particularly the protests against his own return to power, which, of course, were masterminded by Hillary Clinton, as we all know. He became even more determined to preserve his own grip on power by portraying the West, led by the U.S. and NATO, as the ultimate enemy by destroying any Western-oriented alternative that could take root in Russia's neighborhood, and by using militant nationalism and restoration of Russia's great power status as a way of distracting his own people from Russia's economic decline. So my analysis may be a little different than Kim presents in the report. But that said, I do agree with a lot of the recommendations. First of all, we do need to strengthen our defense and deterrence posture so that the Russians don't even think of attacking us. And that implies implementing all the many different decisions from the Warsaw Summit. And I don't think we need to exceed the limits that were established 20 years ago in the NATO-Russia Founding Act, which already have sufficient flexibility. We could, if we wanted to, go a little bit beyond what was decided at Warsaw. But But you know, we don't have to remove any constraints. But I do think that any long-term commitment should be part of a new conventional arms control regime that imposes reciprocal limits on what the Russians can concentrate in terms of substantial combat forces along their western borders. And I would add one thing that's not in the report is if we're thinking about forward defense of NATO, we don't just circle the wagons and protect the 28 or soon to be 29 members. We also have to boost our support for the countries in between NATO and Russia, particularly Ukraine and Georgia, so that they can be less vulnerable to direct or hybrid threats. But of course, resilience is not just about defense. It's also about carrying out fundamental reforms, adopting inclusive policies towards ethnic minorities, so that there are fewer pressure points that Russia can exploit. But probably in the short term, the most immediate priority is just to reduce the risks and of the current relationship, which is indeed quite dangerous, to prevent any accidental incident from spinning out of control. And this means reinforcing agreements like the Bilateral Incidents at Sea Agreement, the OSCE Vienna document, reinvigorating military-to-military exchanges, reviving conventional arms control, bilateral strategic stability talks. You can make a long list, but I think that basically we need to go back to the Cold War playbook and look how to manage a competitive relationship, which we were able to do reasonably effectively during the late decades of the Cold War. And this is, in fact, what NATO allies have been focusing on in the revived meetings of the NATO-Russia Council, which met three times last year and has had just had a meeting the other day. Practical cooperation is suspended, but the focus is on transparency, risk reduction, air safety, and things like that. If we want to really improve the relationship, this goes perhaps beyond the ambition of the report, and not just manage tensions, then we need to tackle head-on the real problem that has caused the relations to deteriorate in the first place. That's Russia's aggression against Ukraine. 3 years after the Minsk agreements, or two years after the second set of Minsk agreements, the situation remains deadlocked on the ground. The Minsk process may have contained further escalation, but has clearly not had the means to solve the conflict. I believe that the Trump administration should consider a much stronger diplomatic leadership role in the negotiations, working with Kiev, Berlin, and Paris, to try to actually get Minsk implemented and avoid another frozen conflict. To do this, we may need to generate more leverage, including possibly tightening the sanctions even further. SWIFT is probably the ultimate sanction we could impose, and being ready to provide lethal defensive weapons to Ukraine if the Russians remain intransigent. And I would hold some of the ideas that you put in the report for reassuring Russia in reserve for the day when they start delivering on their Minsk commitments and actually begin to restore Ukrainian control over the Donbas and more fundamentally return to compliance with Helsinki principles. This includes your no regime change pledge. First, I'd like to get the Russians to pledge that they have forsworn regime change in Minsk, in Kiev, Minsk, Tbilisi, Chisinau, Astana, and maybe other places. And I would also be very hesitant to concede the principle that the Ukrainians have the right to pursue NATO membership, even if the prospects for actually getting there are pretty remote in the next few years. But these are issues on which honest men and women may differ. Again, I want to praise you for an extremely timely and interesting report with some very creative ideas for how to manage NATO-Russia tensions.
Thank you. Thanks. I don't think we disagree all that much.
With that, I want to pose two questions. The first of, Kim mentioned the RAND studies, which noted the ability of, I mean, basically the delayed response times, especially of U.S. Conventional forces to respond. But as people know, it's unlikely that Russia would make that choice with conventional, right? And the gray zone hybrid warfare is the mantra that people at UCOM and the Pentagon talk a lot about. Discuss this beneath the threshold of conflict type of tension raising that Russia can employ and has employed quite successfully. And what are practical steps to identify it, call it out, and mitigate it? And are these activities that the United States and its allies should be doing at higher levels than it does?
That's a really great question, Micah. The scenarios under which Russia could do gray zone conflict against the new NATO countries are sort of infinite. We have not done a very good job of predicting what Russia is going to do in advance of it doing it in many of these questions. And so anything we come up with is not going to be the full range of possibilities. But one that people have talked about is you could imagine that there might be rioting in a border area of Estonia or Latvia, where there is a large Russian ethnic and Russian-speaking population. And those rioters could start calling for Russia to send peacekeeping forces to protect them. And the end result might be that Russian military forces were effectively occupying a very small area, maybe just like a border town or a border city, without trying to take over all the territory. And that's something that people have thought of as being dangerous. And what I suggest in the report is that the best mitigation for that possibility is to try to make the Russian-speaking and Russian ethnic populations of Latvia and Estonia as happy and as integrated into those states as possible. So that if there seems to be this rioting calling for a Russian peacekeeping operation to be deployed on this sovereign territory, that it's very obvious that it's actually coming from Russian special operations forces and not coming from the domestic population. The other thing that I really highlight in the report and that I'd recommend that other states who are concerned about Russian behavior might do is following Estonia's lead in establishing what Estonia calls cyber embassies on the territory of foreign countries in cooperation with Microsoft, where all of the documentary evidence about governmental functioning down to the level of property records is actually stored in a mirror server on the territory of another country, which means that even if there was a successful Russian intervention into just a few kilometers of Estonian territory, Russia might be able to do bad things to the population there, but they couldn't take away property. They couldn't change legal frameworks without everybody knowing what the real situation was. And so there are all kinds of things that you can think about on that level. But I think fundamentally, when it comes to just the kinds of more standard information warfare that we've seen, the kinds of false news stories that come up, it's very hard to think about what we could possibly do to answer lies without trying to engage in conspiracy mongering lies ourselves, because that's what people are attracted to. And so I think the best response is just to call them out when we see them. I did want to highlight one other thing that is probably one of the major recommendations of the report, and I actually have an opinion piece that was published in Fortune last week that details this some more. And that's actually the idea of coming up with a cyber accord with Russia. At the first meeting between Trump and Putin, we don't know exactly when that's going to happen, but this gets at the regime change question that Sandy mentioned. And it is just to say that both sides can now make an agreement that says it is bad to take offensive cyber actions against civilian targets in peacetime, which is exactly what Russia did to the United States in 2016. Mm-hmm. The information that was released, doxing is the technical term for it among people who study cyber issues, the release of the emails was carried out against civilians in peacetime. I go through some of the logic, which I'm happy to talk about in Q&A, about why now might be a good time to do that. But I think there's no harm in the U.S. proposing this, because the U.S. does not have any incentive to get involved in a civilian offensive cyber war with Russia, because we have so many vulnerable systems ourselves.
Well, first of all, on the basic scenario that Kim outlined of the Russians trying to do a limited land grab, ostensibly in response to an appeal from beleaguered Russian co-ethnics, of course, the scenario usually includes the notion that the Russians actually come in and agitate, maybe little green men without military insignias form the core of these riots. And so part of the reason that we're putting the enhanced forward presence, these multinational battalions, into the Baltic states and Poland is to have a force in place that could, you know, nip these sorts of things in the bud. If the Ukrainians had significant forces in Simferopol in the early days, they would have arrested the people who staged the coup and declared a an independent government in Crimea and started the ball rolling for the annexation. So this is part of what NATO is trying to develop as a sort of comprehensive counter hybrid warfare strategy. It includes enhanced intelligence role for, you know, internal security forces being much better lashed up with other NATO intelligence services. I think the biggest challenge is in the information space because, well, I don't think there is a real risk that the Russian-speaking minorities in Latvia and Estonia would actually appeal to Russia to, you know, to take them in. They're pretty happy being citizens of the European Union. And over the last decades, they have been more thoroughly integrated in these countries. But these people tend to watch only Russian state TV these days, so they have a completely warped view of what's going on in their own countries, in Ukraine and other places where the constant drumbeat from the Russian propaganda machine is quite influential. So both we, the U.S., which has the resources, I hope, to continue to do sophisticated Russian language broadcasting, but also the countries themselves have to provide an appealing alternative so that people are not at a steady diet of Russian state media, which, as we know, is quite diabolical in its mind-bending techniques.
The other question I had was on the prospects of a grand bargain, which some people take to mean an agreement between Putin and President Trump about an unwillingness of the U.S. or NATO to interfere or try to have political influence in Russia's spheres of influence in exchange for Russian cooperation on a range of issues, everything from fighting ISIS to stabilizing northern Syria, and NATO allies are particularly worried that this may undercut U.S. Article 5 support. Do you envision something like this happening, and or will the initial meetings, which we don't know when they're going to happen, just be a getting to know you, and it's too soon to do something like this?
I think it's very hard to make predictions about what the new administration will do in the United States because the sense that I get is that it's still finding its feet. We have seen different statements come out from various members of the cabinet about how they would be interested in dealing with Russia, ranging from, you know, more cooperative statements to really pretty condemnatory statements. And so I think it's hard to make predictions. I hope that there is not an effort to make a grand bargain, because I think if we start talking about spheres of influence, that's fundamentally undercutting the liberal democratic ideals that help hold NATO together. And I also think that what we've seen in Syria is that Russia is not a trustworthy actor. It says that it is combating the Islamic State, but actually what it has been doing in the vast majority of its airstrikes and other activities is to shore up the Assad regime, and it has not really been going after the Islamic State. I have talked to some military officers who tell me that when it comes to very basic deconfliction questions, so that there is some degree of confidence that Russia is not going to accidentally bomb U.S. Special Operations Forces in Syria, and the U.S. isn't accidentally going to carry out airstrikes against Russians in Syria, that people seem to have a pretty high degree of confidence that at that very, very minor level, things seem to be working. But beyond that, I would be very hesitant to trust any direction that the Putin administration would propose, because I think that we have plenty of evidence that he is a liar and that he is a KGB officer who will take advantage of the United States and any perceived weaknesses of the United States anywhere that he can.
Very diplomatic. I agree, and of course, any such grand bargain would really be a betrayal of our principles, and it also wouldn't really work. It would not be a sustainable basis for relations between us and Russia or for European security, because as we've seen over decades, going all the way back to East German riots in '53, Budapest '56, Prague Spring, and then, of course, the Rose and Orange Revolutions, and now the Maidan. The people of these countries have a vote, and they aren't going to accept being consigned to a Russian sphere of influence, certainly not for very long. And I think in the 21st century, their tolerance is going to be even less than it may have been under the Soviet domination. So, but it would betray our principles. I don't think we would actually get, as Kim just said, you know, the real kind of cooperation that we would be looking for in fighting ISIS. The Russians have their own agenda in Syria. I think they're also looking to take advantage of the vacuum in Libya. I mean, I think their main objective is to reduce U.S. influence in the Middle East. Fighting terrorism comes second. It's also sort of this revenge agenda regarding regime change. I think one of the main reasons that they went into Syria initially, although their objectives may have increased over time, was to kind of deny the West the ability to carry out another successful regime change operation after what happened in Ukraine, what happened to Gaddafi in Libya. So would the administration go in this direction to a kind of a devil's bargain? I was a little worried about that earlier on, but I think as time has passed, I think it has become less likely. First of all, we've seen through the appointments of Mattis, McMaster, Tillerson, Fiona Hill, a pretty solid team that understands the nature of today's Russia, and I think is going to be quite realistic. We've seen very, very solid statements consistent with what previous administration said and what our allies have been saying regarding Ukraine and the importance of maintaining the linkage between any easing of sanctions and the full implementation of the Minsk agreements and restoration of Ukrainian sovereignty over the Donbas. So while there may have been some hints of just lifting the sanctions as a gesture to Putin, this met a huge congressional backlash. And I think that with all the other travails that the administration is going through with regard to Russia, would be kind of politically suicidal to try to reopen that Pandora's box. So I'm less worried about that. And I hope, as I suggested, that they'll do the opposite, try to kind of demonstrate support for the principles that we all stand for by trying to actually solve Ukraine, succeed where Obama failed, and get the Russians out of the Donbas. Then we could start talking about more substantial cooperation with Russia than is conceivable today.
Russia out of the Donbas would be a great tweet. So I think it's potential. Questions? Yes, sir. We have one.
I was asked principally because I'm from RAND about the RAND study. So I'd like that first explanation to be not a question, because I will have to say to that to make it a question, why am I wrong? But I just to make the statement that no one thinks, and nobody at RAND thinks, that the Russians are about to invade the Baltics. But there is a danger of kind of accidental, inadvertent slide into war, where you might go to very quickly to the nuclear stage. From that, we're all thinking about trying to how to avoid that. And the same with Putin. These things that he does are provocative, but they are meant to kind of test our will and to see how we react. And if we didn't react strongly, then he'll take another step and keep pushing to the point where there won't be any invasion. There won't have to be, because the Baltic countries and many other NATO members will have already given up and decided that the West, and the U.S. in particular, is not going to take any steps so he can do something more. Right. But that isn't what we're not looking at a guy who really wants to make an invasion. But if you take his own way he looked at things, if you go back to his speech at the Munich conference, I was there, I think somebody in this room probably was too. It's quite clear, and when I heard it, I said, this is exactly what most Russians think, because he was basically saying, why the hell is the United States not criticized for doing the things it's done in Iraq? Why is it always Russia? And he has this feeling that, very strongly, that the post-Cold War architecture in Europe doesn't fit the Russian interests, and basically, Russia has been excluded. Now, as Sandy said, we've tried many times to bring Russia in, and including the idea of a strategic partnership with Russia. And so, and the last thing I would just point to is Ukraine. I mean, this happened basically with not really any provocation. In fact, if you look at what happened with the EU summit, it wasn't NATO that was the real problem in the Ukrainian crisis. It was the EU.
Yes.
And in a way, they were right, because soft power is power. You don't have to use for it. And I think, you know, Putin was quite clear that if he allowed the EU to gain influence in Ukraine, there'd come a day when they'd start making more issues that they wanted to join the West, and he'd have lost the advantage of being able to do anything about it. So he decided to act first, again, softly, but to prevent an escalation of the situation, which in fact could have led to an invasion or something.
Thank you. Respond to that quickly.
Well, on the first part about the RAND study and the likelihood of a large-scale Russian invasion is very low, and it is these limited land grabs or probes with a hybrid dimension that we have to worry about. And that's why we think a battalion, while it's not a warfighting capability that will repel large-scale aggression, is enough to deter, to deal with these sort of limited incursions, but also to buy time for reinforcement. The basic NATO strategy is still premised on reinforcement. The forward presence is more of a tripwire, but a kind of tripwire with some sharp teeth. And more importantly, it's multinational, so you know that if you come in, you're not just going to be tackling the Lithuanian home guards. You're going to be dealing with Americans, Germans, Brits, Canadians, and other allies as well. So it still puts a premium on reinforcement, on rapid decision-making, so you can sort of at least initially bring in another battalion or two of reinforcements if you see something brewing, even before you're sure it's going to escalate to the level of a real conflict. We need to get serious about countering this anti-access area denial capability, which could prevent NATO's reinforcements from getting in. A lot of relearning of some of the Cold War specialties, you know, protecting the GI-UK gap and freedom of navigation in the Black and Baltic Seas. As far as the post-Cold War architecture doesn't fit Russian interests, well, that's true. I think we have to believe that what they say. But the problem is they aren't proposing any alternative that we could possibly accept. You know, is it accepting a new division of Europe and spheres of influence, or is it setting up some kind of new European Security Council with a Russian veto, just like the UN Security Council, which would mean the same sort of paralysis that we see on any sensitive issue, such as, you know, the latest chemical weapons attacks in Syria. Ultimately, I think we have to stand our ground, and, you know, it becomes an issue of containment and managing a competitive relationship until Russia is prepared to kind of come back into the system that we were trying to build in the 90s, and which did work even for the first two terms of Putin. But now they seem to have discarded it, as I said, as much for domestic reasons as for international reasons.
Can I just say thank you very much for your comments, and I agree with Sandy completely about the tripwire. That was, you know, the major thing that NATO had in place all throughout the Cold War, and it seems to have worked. And the second recommendation that I make in the report is make sure that our allies follow through with sustaining those new battalions that are deployed in the Baltic states, along with our work in Poland. One thing to think about is that in the report I suggest some alternative offset strategies besides nuclear weapons. Exactly, to avoid the possibility that nuclear weapons are the only thing that we can do. And sanctions is one thing that could really destroy the Russian economy if it got to that point without the employment of nuclear weapons that would destroy Russian people. And so I think that that's a trade-off to keep in mind. I agree with you entirely that Russia is feeling humiliated and left out, and that that is a big part of why Putin is so popular, that he's bringing Russia back in again. And that's what people are thinking about. I think that the biggest mistake there was probably on our part, not NATO enlargement, but instead the very sudden decision to leave the ABM treaty unilaterally. I think it could have been renegotiated rather than having the unilateral withdrawal, because that treaty had been the real focal point of arms control during the Cold War, and it recognized the Soviet Union and then Russia as an equal to the United States, and saying that the United States could act unilaterally without taking Russian concerns into account, I think was a big political mistake that helped add fuel to the fire that Putin has.
Thank you. Amy.
Thanks very much, Amy Nelson from the Center for International Security Studies at Maryland and the Stimson Center. I wonder about a complex interplay of weapons-related issues, and I haven't had a chance to do more than skim your policy recommendations, but how is reassuring Russia that ballistic missile defense is aimed at countering Iran any different or an improvement over the U.S.'s existing policy on the issue? Second, the idea of getting a cyber agreement runs headfirst into the problem of preparation of the battlefield. So if you're going to constrain capabilities in peacetime, it's really difficult to sort of get around this problem. And third, the CFE treaty has been derailed in large measure because of, so Russia has said, because of ballistic missile defense, and it covers, no. how would you propose including and incorporating emerging and evolving weapons technologies in a new agreement?
Sure. Great. Those are very good questions. On the ballistic missile defense question, I have to give credit to Austin Long, who had long conversations with me about this. I think the change from the existing policy is that it puts action where the words are. So we have kept on saying that the ballistic missile defense systems are only against Iran or elsewhere against North Korea. And we have said that, you know, the technology indicates that those could not be altered to do something that would harm the Russian strategic deterrent unless there were massive changes in the technology that Russia would have plenty of warning time about. But if you are dealing with a paranoid Putin, the possibility of those technology changes is still concerning. And so the logic behind this is that if you don't put the missiles in place unless Iran does something that is bad behavior, then that's an indication that it's there as a capability. We could probably, you know, we'd have enough lead time if Iran started approaching breakout or started doing something that violated the agreement, that those ballistic missile defense systems could actually be made operational. And by just holding back a little bit, it's sending a message that we're not just talking about this, but that we actually understand Russian concerns and that we're trying to meet them without doing anything that harms ourselves. So that's on your first question. On the second question, I'm not recommending limiting any of our cyber capabilities. What I am recommending doing is reaching an agreement with Russia that says that in peacetime, we will not attack each other's civilians, including through doxing of documents, you know, of emails or of other medical documents or anything else you could think of that would be subject to cyber attacks. And so it's a very limited cyber accord. In the opinion piece that I did for Fortune, I go into more depth explaining why I think it's better than the cyber accord that was reached with China under the Obama administration, because that accord tried to pretend that you would stop people from engaging in espionage against each other using cyber means. But of course, the best cyber espionage is never seen, and so you can't stop it from happening. And in fact, Russia and the United States distrust each other, and so you would expect there to be espionage occurring. It's just a question of what you do with the material that you uncover in espionage. And so what I recommend is just not making it public. And this is part of the protecting, the recognition that neither side is going to actively engage in regime change. So it would be asking Russia to make a big change from what it did in 2016. On the CFE treaty, I don't think it was derailed by ballistic missile defense. I think it was derailed by the positioning of Russian forces in Georgia and Moldova at the time that the amended CFE treaty was signed in 1999. That meant that it could not be ratified for a couple of reasons. One is that there were Russian troops that were deployed illegally inside members of the CFE treaty, but it also meant that there were no safeguards on having Russian heavy weapons dispersed beyond the area because there were Russian heavy weapons where they weren't supposed to be, and so it was already a violation of the accord. And so that's when things really started not going well. And I would agree with Sandy that I think since then the excuse that is given of the ballistic missile defense or the excuse that Putin has been talking about this terrible NATO buildup on its borders is just an excuse. And it does play well to the Russian public. It feeds into this sense of lost status and of NATO taking advantage of it. But I don't think that's what's really derailing the treaty.
Yeah. A couple comments on this. The Russians, I think, actually know, their rocket scientists know that the NATO ballistic missile defense system, both the active site in Romania and the future site in Poland, have zero impact on Russia's strategic deterrent forces, which go over the North Pole. They cannot be shot down by SM-3 missiles based in those two locations. And if you look at a map, you draw a line from Tehran to London, or Tehran to Madrid, or to Oslo, the place you would put these interceptors to shoot down an Iranian missile is precisely Romania and Poland. It has nothing to do with Russia. So I think that, you know, they may have this long-term paranoia about some futuristic technologies that the U.S. will someday deploy, which could neutralize their deterrent. And that's why I think they're waging this dishonest campaign against the far more limited systems that are being deployed by NATO. And it's just the sort of the proximity, even though it doesn't give you capability against Russia, but it's just sort of irks them that their former satellites are hosting advanced U.S. weapon systems. But I think the solution to that is not the one you suggest, which would cause a major rift in NATO. The Poles would be on the warpath if we didn't deliver the systems promised for next year. I think, and also it would remove our capacity to defend against conventional Iranian nuclear weapons. The missile defense has never been exclusively linked to the nuclear threat. The conventionally armed Iranian missiles are pretty potent as well. And the Russians have recently shown by firing caliber missiles at Syria from long distances that conventionally armed missiles can do a lot of damage and can be unacceptable leverage to a state like Iran. So the solution there, I think, is transparency, site visits, exchanging more information. And, you know, if the Russians need to find some kind of process to calm down over the BMD, I think it's through a transparency and inspections regime, which NATO has offered, U.S. has offered, but it was never taken up. On the other ones, I'll be brief. The cyber agreement, it sounds good, but how could you ever be confident the Russians would live up to it? And of course, there's, even on our own side, the ability to collect intelligence, not to then use the stolen information for destabilizing somebody's political system, but the protecting the right to collect intelligence, I think, is something we wouldn't want to give up any more than the Russians would. So it might be seen as a sort of a shiny object that has very little content in terms of its actual implementation. Finally, on CFE, I agree that it was the Russians' unwillingness to remove their forces from Transnistria and from the occupied parts of Georgia that made it impossible for the Western countries to ratify the adapted treaty. But I think it's a more fundamental concern on Putin's part that it's unacceptable to impose any constraints on the movement of Russian forces within its own borders. So therefore, what was for NATO, and particularly for the Turks and the Norwegians, flank limits that would kind of limit concentration of Russian forces in these strategic regions, Putin no longer could accept that. So sort of ever getting back into CFE talks, while important, may founder over the same issue again.
We have four questions in 4 minutes.
I will give you a chance to respond
quickly. So I'm going to take a couple. So we need faster questions, faster responses. Sir, we'll take you and then you right here. So please.
Mike Mazzetic, PBS Online News Hour. Are you going to have to go back to the drawing boards if Le Pen wins the election in France, which is not an absurd possibility? If you believe the polls there, you believe them in Brexit in the United States.
Thank you. My name is Anders Åslund. I'm from the Atlantic Council. A bit on the objectives of Russia. It appears to me, as Sandy suggested, that it's much more on domestic politics than on foreign policy, that foreign policy is simply a means for domestic position of Putin. And the very popular phrase from 1904 in Russia is, we need a small victorious war. And I think that's the principle by which Putin lives. On economics, it's very striking. He wants macroeconomic stability and recently couldn't care less about economic growth. He understands that there is an economic constraint, therefore small wars, but he needs war in order to whip up patriotism so that people support him. What that leads then to conclusion is what my late friend Boris Nemtsov used to say, Putin believes and respects Article 5. And therefore, I think that one should look more upon Balkans, and as Sandy suggested, post-Soviet countries, rather than the Baltics. I'm Swedish, but I'm less worried for the balls, because I think it's very wise that they make a lot of noise, but I don't think that it's a real danger. It's the, where people don't talk that it's really dangerous. Thank you.
We have one other one over here. All right. We'll cut it off, and then please answer those and any final comments, thoughts.
Okay, so on,
respond to Sandy.
Okay, on I'm going to do response to Sandy first, because those were good questions. The first is, how do you have confidence that the cyber accord would work? The confidence comes not from the U.S. government releasing information about what Russian activities are, but from private companies releasing the information. And I would argue that the most important thing that came out of the cyber attack last year was not the government report that came out, but instead the report that CrowdStrike published on its website in June 2016, and then reinforced with a case study from the past year that appeared in January 2017, where they go item by item explaining exactly how the code was linked to Russia, why they think it was the GRU, the Russian Military Intelligence Agency, and the FSB, the follow-on intelligence force from the KGB, rather than somebody trying to spoof them. And certainly you can disagree with them, but that's where all the evidence is. And so what I suggest is that if you have this agreement with Russia, you'd have private companies having a very strong incentive to go after Russia if it violates it. And what you get is Russian humiliation for violating the agreement. And the U.S. hasn't lost anything because the U.S. doesn't want to go after civilians in peacetime with cyber offense anyway. The second point that Sandy raised was the question of the CFE and Putin not wanting to limit what his forces did during inside Russia's own borders. What I suggest in the report is that it's really premature right now to think about jumping straight into arms control, and that what we should do first is focus on military-to-military agreements and open up, change the law that got put into place a couple of years ago that says that lower-level military officers can't talk to each other on the two sides, and then use that as sort of a testing ground to see what the level of cooperativeness is on Russia's part. And if they're not interested, no, CFE is not going to be on the playbook anytime soon. On Le Pen and France, I mean, that's the question that everybody's asking, right? I think that's a very good question. I'm not an expert on French politics at all. But what I do understand is that actually the power of the presidency in France is not, you know, it's not dictatorial power. Yes, the president does have the leadership role in foreign policy, but we've had a history of France being a partial player in NATO before, and NATO still survived. And so as long as we're not in a situation where it's likely to lead to a cascade effect, I think that the future of NATO as a whole is not in question. And I think it was very positive that the Netherlands election went the way that it went. And that it appears in Germany that somebody who is more moderate is probably going to be the person who wins the election. So yes, if Le Pen wins, we're going to be in some difficulty, but I think it's deal withable.
I like that.
Okay. On this question, on Le Pen winning the election, I think the bigger impact and the people needing to go back to the drawing board would be more on the European Union side. Yeah. If you had a Frexit, even as they're just beginning to negotiate the terms of Brexit. But let's hope that the French voters provide a different outcome. I think for NATO, as Kim said, we have dealt with partial French integration in the past. We've never had to deal with any country actually leaving NATO before. I'm not sure that, given the checks and balances even under the French Constitution, whether that is likely to be the outcome. But anyway, thanks for raising that worst-case scenario. In terms of what Anders said, I certainly agree that Putin does kind of thrive now on the siege mentality that he's inculcated in the public debate. If he needs another small victorious war, then we should be providing more military assistance to the Ukrainians, or figuring out whether we can deter him from doing the same thing to Belarus, which is going through some serious upheavals right now. But what I hope we can find is sort of some way to encourage Putin to recognize that this is leading Russia ultimately into a dead end. Being the bad boy gets you some benefits in the short term, and it's a lot easier when you have no checks and balances to take quick decisions to send off troops to Syria, or to escalate the tensions against Ukraine. But ultimately, Russia has much deeper problems that it has neglected for years in terms of its economic decline, the lack of structural reform, demographic decline, rampant breakdown of social infrastructure, the healthcare system, et cetera. So Russia ultimately will become the hollow superpower, and the kinds of dissatisfaction that were manifest in somewhat remarkable form in the protests 2 weekends ago could happen again on a larger scale. So sooner or later, I think it's the economy stupid has to be a principle that applies to Putin's Russia. And then we need to find ways to encourage him to see a way out of this dead end by engaging on a solution to the biggest problem that he's created, which is Ukraine. And maybe the appeal of being accepted once again as a legitimate interlocutor of the great powers, sitting at the top table, may be part of a climb down strategy for Putin from the current confrontational stance, which unfortunately he does see as his best bet in the short to medium term. And on Article 5, I think it's the Ukrainians learned the very bitter experience that without Article 5, you are not as secure as you would be. And I think the debate on NATO membership in Finland and Sweden has evolved in recent years. They've become extremely close partners, participating even in crisis management exercises, dealing with hybrid scenarios in the Baltic states, recognizing that we kind of share very deep interests and have complementary capabilities for dealing with those situations. But being a partner is not the same thing as being a member. In fact, NATO may get more benefit from these countries than those countries derive from NATO if they stick with the status of partner.
Well, please check out the report and join me in thanking Professor Marten and Ambassador Vershbow.
Thank you for the great questions.
That was great.
Fun.
Thank you. Yeah.